So, I realized with my whole leaving for the week thing that it had occurred to me last minute that I was going to have to do two of these videos at once. So I needed to come up with another one real quick. And I was literally on the phone with you when we were trying to figure this out.
Yep.
And I saw my DVD case for Face Off sticking out like it does because of this box.
Yeah.
And I just said, why don't we do Travolta's John Woo movies? And I just threw it out there. So, because I had been thinking, it had been a long time since I had seen Broken Arrow, and I was dying to see it again, just to see how it held up. Needless to say, hilarity ensued, but in a good way, of course. So, yes, this was the idea that I decided to stick to. So, yeah. No real big deal at all, just two John Woo directed over-the-top action movies where John Travolta gets to show off one of my favorite things that he does, which is when John Travolta plays a villain, there's nothing else like it. It is so goddamn over-the-top and hammy, but he's so awesome.
It's true.
And it's fantastic. So there is not you have not seen over the top hammy great until you've seen John Travolta play a villain. See Pelham 1-2-3 as well.
Yep.
And The Punisher.
Punisher.
Swordfish to an extent, but anyway, fuck, even Carrie.
Yeah.
So, we're gonna go ahead and start with Face Off. Broken Arrow came first, but we're gonna start with Face Off. I'm pretty sure. I think it's 96 and 97 and not 97 and 98. The only absolute known fact in this is that Face Off is 1997. So I'm pretty sure it's 96, 97.
I'm looking at the covers, but that doesn't always tell me what's new and what's old.
Yeah, because Travolta is making the same damn face. I'm almost positive this is the exact same picture.
Pretty sure that's on the Look Who's Talking cover too, to be honest.
Oh, God. So, anyway. The interesting thing about Face Off is you'll notice that for a modern action movie, the concept is really, really out there. The idea of taking your opponent's face and putting it on yourself surgically so you can pose as him. And villain figures out the plan and does the same thing and takes over your life thing. Well, it makes a lot of sense when you learn that, before anything else happened, I forget who the director was that had it, but long ago, like in the 80s, this movie was going to be a sci-fi movie starring Schwarzenegger and Stallone.
That would
And
have been
so,
interesting.
yeah, you start to think about it, like, you start to think about the concept of the prison, like being a giant magnet and stuff like that, you know, Escape Plan,
Total Recall meets Escape Plan.
they did together much later. And, you know, the whole concept, and you think, yeah, it's not surprising at all that this was once a sci-fi idea.
No, not at all.
But they took it and made it into this modern action movie idea, and it works awesomely. You wouldn't think so, but it does.
Could be a horror movie too. If you want to take this concept.
What, in like a Raising Kane kind of way or something?
Somewhat, yeah.
So, the interesting thing about this movie is that I've noticed immediately. I remember when I first saw this movie, it was at my dad's friend's house in Kansas when I first saw this movie. And I was really, really. I walked in the middle of it. I walked in, like, as soon as, you know, Castor woke up from the coma. But still, what little grasp I had on the concept, I was pulled in by this movie immediately. And that was back when I was like squeamish and shit. So I thought, for the longest time, I thought this was the bloodiest fucking thing I had ever seen. But I loved it. I got it on video and I watched it over and over again. Even though, so much so, I loved it so much that you know how when you watch long movies as a kid, they seem really, really long and drawn out. It was forever before I realized this movie is almost 2.5 hours. It's 2 hours and 20 minutes.
Doesn't seem that way at
I
all.
never, I never would have guessed.
It flows very nicely.
And one cool thing immediately is when you have a big action movie, it's best to pull your audience in as soon as possible, with an action scene. Preferably one that goes within, like, you have Bond movies or, like, say, Steven Seagal movies or something, where you have an action scene that's meant to pull you in, but has no connotation with the rest of the story whatsoever. Not only does this movie introduce us to the story and give us a big action scene immediately, the beginning of this movie, if you walk in on it, feels like a climax. Like, if you, like, I would, this movie, the beginning of this movie, like, as soon as the beginning credits are over, looks so much like the end of a giant action movie.
Yep.
And that was a really cool way to start it off. And it's a massive scene, too. It's like a 20-minute opening scene. And it introduces us to our two characters. We have Sean Archer, whose son has been accidentally killed by Castor Troy, who was aiming for Sean. And Castor Troy, terrorist extraordinaire, and total and complete drugged out psychopath. Now, Travolta is good in this. Travolta is really good, and I will talk about him more. I love him as Castor Troy, getting to do the really big over-the-top villainy stuff. And he's really good as Sean being that, you know, stone-faced protagonist. That's, you know, revenge-seeking.
But, for the love of God,
this is the ultimate. There are a lot of roles that he has just made his absolute own. But there is no fucking Nicolas Cage part like Castor Troy. This is Cage being full on 150,000% off the wall Cage.
This is why the Conan bit exists. To go to this level.
And what's really fantastic here is how he's able to do both. Because it's really cool that Travolta can be, you know, stone-faced, revenge-seeking good guy, and then go into cool, over-the-top villain mode. But what the way Cage is supposed to go in the other direction, at the starting point that he is at... And I love it. I love hearing... Travolta had a lot to say on his Inside the Actor's Studio about making this movie, with Cage in particular. And what would happen is they would film their scenes as the characters they start off as, and the other would watch so they knew how to play the character later. And so, you know, Cage watched Travolta, you know, do the, you know, any word from the LAPD intelligence, if there is such a thing. We'll take a break when the case breaks, stuff like that. So he goes to the scene at the LA Convention Center where the bomb is placed. And we have Castor Troy dressed up as a priest. And he comes out to Hallelujah, dancing, and does the clap and then head-swinging thing. And immediately Travolta said, oh, okay, that's what we're doing. I see now. Oh my god. And that, I believe the image everybody uses when they think Crazy Cage Face, there are two, and they both come from this performance. You have the scene where he grabs the choir girl's ass while singing Hallelujah and does the eyes thing. And then there's the prison thing when he's trying to convince Pollux who he is and does the I'm Castor Troy face. This is Cage. It is absolute where everybody knows and loves him. And then how he's able to go and be Sean Archer. It's really an incredible performance. Like, I know people are quick to blow him off in this movie because of the way he plays Castor Troy, but it's the fact that he's able to play Troy that way and then go into Archer afterwards. It's a really magnificent performance. Because he's really... I mean, there are those times where he's Archer where he gets to, you know, scream and yell angrily, or... You know, he still cages out sometimes. Like, when he's... It's a pure Cage moment when he's Archer and he's trying to explain to Eve... what's going on when he says, you know, they went through the surgery and, you know, they gave me Troy's face. That is definitely a Cage moment, but it's the rest of the performance is really, really downplayed when he doesn't have to do that stuff. And it works really, really well. And now he's able to play this ultimate, you know, psychotic villain and then play this really, really honest-to-God protagonist. He does not get enough credit for this performance, is what I'm trying to say. How much time have I spent talking about just Cage here? But yes, it's fantastic. And another thing that works really well, apart from the fact that it's a really great, often mimicked action movie, Like, it's a movie that seems like it just kind of came and went in the 90s, and people liked it, and then it went. But you don't realize how many action movies, even still nowadays, are a parody of the action scenes in this movie.
It's true.
John Woo and his fucking doves, I believe, started with this. The moment in 21 Jump Street, when they show up for the big action scene and the big shootout, and they bring the box of doves with them. It's a general John Woo trademark, but I think this is where it's most noted. There's a lot of the whole pointless rolling and then shooting stuff. It's just this, it's the ultimate John Woo action movie. It really is. But apart from that, it also handles other things really well. The family drama, which would be really, really secondary in another movie, is really, really well played here, especially since they got an actress the caliber of Joan Allen to play Eve. Works really well. And one thing that also makes it really stand out and kind of be something that's kind of above its concept, because people hear the concept and they think, wow, that has dumb action movie written all over it. The way the surgery is shot, like, we actually see the entire surgery play out. And you think that would just maybe be, you know, a reach for just having, you know, cheap, you know, reasons to have gore in there. But the way this surgery scene is shot is really, really well crafted, because they do everything they can to show you the surgery in full, but not necessarily the gore aspect of it. Because every time we see somebody without their face, without the skin on their face, it's either blurry in the background out of focus, or it's like a really, really quick shot, or it cuts away just in time. I really love the moment when, after Casper's woken up and taken the bandage off, and he's walking towards the doctor, clapping, and we just get really, really fast cuts of him without his face, almost to where you can't even see it, and the only full shot we get is in the reflection of his glasses. I thought that was a really cool way to handle that stuff. Because I can just see some movie saying, you're like, hey, let's just make this the most fucking disgusting movie ever and show everybody with their goddamn faces off. They handled it really, really well. In a movie that also, you know, does not shy away from gore and blood by any means, that they handled that particular case so well and didn't feel the need they had to really, you know, show it, I think speaks volumes about the way it was handled. And it's just, I love watching them play off each other and how they both kind of do their own thing. Like, it's clearly them doing each other, but then also, there's the moment where, I guess Travolta actually ad-libbed the moment where he's talking to Pollux about how much he hates being in this body, and he's like, you know, everything he hates about it, up to and including this ridiculous chin, which is something Travolta's known for. If I remember correctly, Travolta ad-libbed that part, so that's, that he was having that much fun with it, says a lot. Much like in last week we were talking about, there are quite a few familiar faces in this movie that may not have been big at the time. One that really stood out was Burke Hicks, the prisoner in the prison that knows Caster, that kind of says, you know, like, hey, you know, remember the little people? And the guy that he says, you know, you want to see what wasted looks like, little man? It's Thomas Jane. It took me forever to notice that.
Now it makes sense. Now it makes even more sense, his casting in The Punisher.
Yeah. And then somebody in the FBI, Margaret Cho, of all people,
yep,
is in this movie, which is weird. And then, you know, there's all kinds of side characters like Harvey Preston and CCH Pounder, and just a whole bunch of those recognizable faces that you know, you may not be able to put a name with, but you know their face. Alessandro Nivola himself, Pollux, is one of those people. Nick Cassavetes, Gina Gershon. This cast is huge. And there's so many people. John Carroll Lynch is the big intimidating guard. One of your favorite people. John Travolta's daughter is Dominique Swain.
Yep. That's what I was referring to.
I'm not totally completely positive. I want to say that was Danny Masterson, is the guy that tries to, like, rape her.
I think you're right.
if not, it looked a lot like him. That or Johnny Galecki and his Roseanne days. So, yes, it's worth noting for that, too. But another brilliant thing that it does here is the way it handles its story. Because really, you see the title, obviously. Obviously, you have to write the title with a slash in the middle, because I guess I guess Paramount was worried that people were going to mistake it for a hockey movie if you didn't put the slash in there. I don't know if that would be able to tell the difference or what, but no, given what the title is, it's clearly a double meaning. You have the really over-the-top title draw. This is like the scene everybody goes to when you think of over-the-top, you know, ways of shoehorning the title of your movie into actual dialogue. When he's talking to Nick Cassavetes about what he wants to do to Archer when he finds him. I believe most of the Nicolas Cage impressions I hear are just them saying, "Face off." But the way it actually handles its story, where, it starts off, obviously, with, the idea is to become Caster so you can go to Pollux and find out where the bomb is hidden. Mm-hmm. And that happens relatively quickly, and you're like, okay, good, that was easy, he can get out now, right? But then you have this problem come in where Caster takes his form, and then you think, oh, I see where this is going now. But then, not even halfway through the movie, Caster gets the brilliant idea of, let's just say fuck all this, and I'll disarm the bomb and be the hero cop. And then, once that is accomplished, the whole mission is over. So the entire movie now is boiled down to the vendetta itself. And I love that they did that, especially so early, because it's really unexpected that they turn the story in that direction so fast. And then, you know, action scenes galore. But apart from that, you know, it's just one of those movies where I'm really surprised just how much they devote to the characters. That probably has to do with, you know, its runtime, that they actually care to do that. Like, get into the whole Sasha and Dietrich brother-sister storyline, and then the fact that, you know, Sasha has Caster's kid and happens to really closely resemble the kid that Caster killed. Which takes us to the really... It's really cheesy now to put that not necessarily appropriate for the scene, but still works anyway song. But no, the Over the Rainbow shootout is really badass. and then it just keeps building. This climax, it gets a lot of shit because people think it makes the movie too long, but I love the climax for this movie because it just keeps fucking going. Like, they really, really play up that this vendetta, this fight, has been needing to happen for the whole movie, and it fucking does. We start off with the Mexican standoff at the funeral, and then we progress into the scene where they have to convince the daughter which one's the real one and which one she's going to end up shooting and saving. And then there is a small pursuit, and then there's the dock, and they get on the boat. And then this has now progressed into a big-ass boat chase. And then once they've completely wrecked and destroyed both boats, this is what, obviously it's a John Woo movie, things explode spontaneously, and it's fantastic. After this giant boat chase, after all of this, it finally ends in an all-out brawl between the two of them on the beach with whatever weapons they can find from the boat explosion. It's just this absolute massive climax that really, really earns how big it is. So, that's what I really love. This is like one of the ultimate vendetta movies, where you just have a good guy and a bad guy that just fight to the death. And that's what the whole movie is, really. And it's fantastic, and it's just that awesome twist that they just happen to look like each other. It's obvious, of course, and you see it kind of from a mile away, but you do have to love the scene where Travolta says, okay, I give up, why don't we just kill each other? And they turn around, and they're both facing a mirror, but shooting at each other from the opposite side. It's a badass fucking movie. I also loved going to the Planet Hollywood in Florida, which yes. Showcases their guns.
I have pictures of these, actually.
Yes. And lastly, I almost kind of like... I mean, I don't think you're supposed to see it this way. I believe it's supposed to be a totally happy ending. But let's be honest for a second. The whole movie, Caster Troy took Sean Archer's son, shot him in the head and killed him. Accident or no accident, killed him with really no remorse. Caster Troy, if anything, does not have fucking remorse. The guy that says, if I were to ask you to suck my tongue, would you be grateful? Does not feel remorse for anybody. So, the thing about it is, this is kind of the way I see it. It is a really nice, happy ending, too. It's really, really rushed, but it's a happy ending nonetheless. So, like, I was, you know, he walks up to Eve, and Dominic Swain's already showing him his room and everything, and he's like, you know, is it okay? And she's like, yes, of course, and they kiss, and the credits are always like, what if she said, fuck no, it's not okay? What if that happened? Because it was really abrupt, like, he didn't even, like, she didn't even know the other kid existed. But here's what I'm thinking. What if that, happy ending as it is his final fuck you to Caster Troy by saying, hey, you took my son, so now your son is mine. Because it's kind of weird you think about that, because how much they hated each other, and Eve too, even if the kid isn't innocent, and it's not the kid's fault at all, the kid is a total and complete innocent. But nevertheless, that is Caster Troy's flesh and blood living in their house.
Yeah.
You'd think that'd be a little fucked up for them, regardless. Even if it does mean saving the kid. Because, you know, Sasha's dead now. He's orphaned now. Yeah, what if that was just his way of saying, hi, Caster, you're fucking dead and I have your child now.
One way to look at it.
You know, Sean Archer had it out for him that much, you know. It wouldn't be that surprising.
No. Not at all.
Alright, so yes, that is the absolute greatness that is Face Off. So, as I said, I watched Broken Arrow again recently, just for the shits and giggles. this was my favorite fucking action movie when I was a kid.
Really?
This movie was so badass to me when I was a kid. Like, when I was like, you know, 8 and making my action figure movies, this movie was a massive inspiration.
So I can see that now, honestly.
This movie really inspired those movies I made with action figures when I was 9 or 10. So, what happens here is, this movie is the quintessential... Well, I thought Face Off, while, you know, being perceived as a big dumb action movie, is actually really smart in how it handles it, the stuff that it does. Even if, you know, stuff spontaneously explodes, but it's a John Woo movie, you have to get over that. If a boat hits something, whether it's just a rock, even if there's nothing explosive even remotely within distance, the fucking thing's gonna blow up into a mushroom cloud.
Of course.
Broken Arrow is the ultimate quintessential dumb action movie to me. Like, there are people who, you know, like, have a Van Damme movie they say that about, or a Seagal movie they say that about, or whatever. Broken Arrow is that movie for me. The action scenes are so badass and make no fucking sense, but... everything is just so awesome, you just can't help but love it anyway. Everything the characters do in this movie is a dumb decision. A lot of it does not even... This is one of those cases where somebody can be at the bottom of a cave and have the service to talk to somebody in Utah. there is a thermonuclear weapon with a big red digital clock on it. and this relationship between Travolta and Slater, this blew my mind when I saw it. I hadn't seen Pulp Fiction, I hadn't seen Face Off yet, I hadn't seen anything of the like. I hadn't seen Blowout or any of his De Palma work, I had just seen this. And I had seen, like, Look Who's Talking and stuff like that. And probably a bunch of other movies that are escaping me right now. Probably Grease at some point.
Did you see Phenomenon?
That probably was one right about that time.
They were out the same time, actually.
Watching Travolta in this part as a bad guy, saying fuck every two words, blew my mind.
It's like for me watching The Rock and Doom.
Yeah, I could not believe what I was watching, and I thought it was the most badass thing I had ever seen. And they play him up so goddamn over the top. Every time... Deacons moves or says something, he's being very, very villainy about it. The only thing he's missing is a mustache and a spinning chair.
The old cat.
Yes.
Forget about the cat.
Like, every single word he says, like, through the entire movie, he talks through clenched teeth. Like, one of my favorite lines in the movie, I still say to this day, just in random conversation, is... would you mind not shooting at the thermonuclear weapons?
I've heard you say that before, actually.
And the way he, like, smokes his cigarettes in that very villainy way. Pretty much every other move he makes is in slow-mo. It's hilarious, but it's so... it works. He's so bad. And it's awesome. And I know, and it's totally, like, I totally get how laughable this movie is. There's the whole thing where they keep betting each other $20, so, like, when you know, he takes the bombs and he blames it on Hale and he, you know, shoots him out of the plane. The first thing Hale does when he lands is say, well, Deke, you won this one. And he sets a $20 bill down on the desert floor. Who the fuck would do that? But okay, he's fine. He's very, very loyal. And I love that it sets it up immediately. Like, it's supposed to be kind of like a twist there at the very beginning that Travolta's bad, because he just seems like a douchebag for a while there. Mm-hmm. But it's so goddamn obvious. And mm-hmm. I love the reveal, too. Number one, this is the way this kind of movie is. It's a movie about hijacked thermonuclear weapons and these two going after each other. The opening credit scene is them fighting in a boxing ring. That is how much they want to show you that this is a vendetta movie, really. And it's kind of surface, you know, because this movie has such underlying themes to it. But no, everything about it, not just that, but all the villains are over the top. Howie Long is in this, Bob Gunn is in this, and they play just these really despicable characters, but they're so laughably bad. And there's like the moment where it's the guy, they're posing as park rangers and they go out. And it's a dude and his wife has a cold, so he built her a campfire. And there's just this really innocent people. And he's like, hey, I'm here to talk to you about your campfire. And he's like, I know I'm not supposed to have it, but my wife has a cold, and I'm just trying to keep her warm. Because he's a wonderful, loving husband. So how they handle this is they shoot the wife in the head through the tent, and then shoot the guy down. And it's not enough that they do that, but he falls face first into the campfire and is set ablaze. And then, there's another scene where some park rangers come out, and one of them's eating a candy bar. And just to show you how fucking evil they are, he shoots the park rangers down, and then goes over and takes the guy's fucking candy bar and starts eating it. It's great. Oh my god. This movie, like, when you're looking for a really stupidly amazing bad action movie, this is so much what you're looking for. And the climax. The climax of this movie. Oh, another thing I was about to mention real quick. The reveal that Travolta's bad. Talking about really over-the-top villain stuff. Are you ready? They're talking, and I don't know if this was always the plan, or if he just kind of, this is like what set him off or what, but obviously Deakins is extremely power-hungry. Like, he talks to Bob Gunn about, you know, you don't share power. It's never a good idea. Hale makes a comment about Deakins likes thinking he has the power of God at his fingertips. And apparently, this seems to be what sets him off. So what happens is, the music gets really dark, and Deakins looks at him, squinting with evil eyes, and we zoom in on him. This guy's not the fucking bad guy at all.
Nope, not at all.
Oh my god. Okay, so, the ending of this movie is a big, massive set piece where they're on a train. And we have one weapon left because he blew the other one up, basically just to see if it worked. And he put a massive hole in the ground. Let's not lie, it's fucking badass. So, this big sequence takes place. He's got Delroy Lindo in the helicopter, he's got Frank Whaley back at the base, and everybody's got everything going on. You got Kurtwood Smith being like the secretary of whatever the fuck, just overseeing everything. And you just have this big John Woo action scene atop this train that keeps going over big bridges for some reason. I don't know how much water is in this movie, but they keep going over big, massive drop-off bridges so that Howie Long can meet his hilarious end. So we have the bomb keeps getting turned on and off, and you can control this through a small little remote control that has arm and disarm and numbers on it. That's all it's got. And so many things just come to a peak in this scene. There are people that fall off the train and get run over and die. There's obvious dummies being used. Things explode for no reason. Like, if there's a gas leak, but no sign of a flame whatsoever, the helicopter just fucking explodes and takes half the train with it. And then there's the great moment where, Howie Long has to pull a gun on him because Deakins has lost his mind now, even more so. Deakins has lost his mind so much. They are on a train a moving train that is not stopping anytime soon with this thermonuclear weapon. And Deacon says the line, fuck them if they can't take a joke. And he switches 29 minutes to 5 minutes. It's like, dude, you're on the fucking train with it.
You're not going to go anywhere.
And so, Christian Slater screams incoming, comes flying into the train on a rope tied to I don't know what. And Tarzan's in and kicks Howie Long through the other side of the train, and he goes flying off the bridge, and it's that stock screaming sound. And it's the greatest thing I've ever seen. And then finally, what we've been building up to, this moment where Hale and Deacons come together, and they fight. They get into a gun battle, and then Deacons throws down his weapon and throws his fists up, and we are reliving the boxing match on this speeding train with an armed nuclear weapon on it. And they're beating the shit out of each other with their fists. And I just love this so much. Like, the line you talked about seeing in all the commercials where he says, you know, like, Deacons, you have lost your fucking mind. And his response is, yeah, ain't it cool? And I love the build into the line. It's the ultimate cheesy action line where he just says, I'm serious, dude, you have completely lost your mind. Maybe, but I'm still gonna kick your ass. And they just beat the holy fuck out of each other.
You hear that in the bar most of the time, about 2 o'clock every night.
And the, you know what it feels like to be knocked out? Your brain presses against your skull and it feels like this, and he just shoves his thumb into his temple. And then the ultimate ending to this. If you want to talk over the top, like, action movies, the best thing you can possibly do, if you're an over the top action movie, is kill your villain accordingly.
Oh, yeah.
And, oh my god, you will not believe, you have to go to YouTube or something to find it. But if I tell you how John Travolta dies in this movie, you would not believe me. Let's just put it this way. Christian Slater has just enough time to disarm the bomb and jump off the train, just as two trains collide. And what happens here is, the way this nuclear weapon is very conveniently shaped, is it's like a giant pencil. It's a really long portion here, and then it comes to a point, a metal point. Well, here's the thing. The bomb is here on this end of the train, the car, and Travolta is here on the other end. And the two trains collide, and it propels the weapon at him. And to see how this outcome, I cannot explain it. It is too dumb for words, but it's one of the best fucking villain deaths I have ever seen. And lastly, we have to end on a terrible, horrible innuendo. I swear to God, as soon as that happens, we see the fucking $20 bill again. And then he goes up to Samantha Mathis. A really cool Pump of the Volume reunion, by the way. And the very last line of the movie, after all this has happened, really, really abruptly, the big explosion happens and everything happens. And then they come and they find each other. And they introduce each other by name. They've been on this quest through the whole movie, but they never introduce each other, is the joke. And then, because she's a park ranger, and because he has committed some crimes, to say the least, you know, all the explosions and stuff, he takes her hand and he says, well, I guess you gotta take me in. And the movie ends. And this movie is everything you want it to be.
Yeah, it's true.
And I still, despite all of its stupidity, and just the complete idiocy of what I just told you about that happens, I fucking love this movie. I will watch this movie. I don't know how many times I've seen this movie, I swear to God. When I watched it again recently, it had been years. It had been years since I saw it. I remembered every fucking line in every action scene and every moment of it. And now that I've relived it again recently, I will probably do so more. Yes, that's just a shitload of fun. But, you know, let's be real. When you put the two against each other, Face Off is really tough to beat. Face Off is like one of the great quintessential action movies.
Yeah.
And it has a reputation to suit it. I love how much it's held up over the years. In 2 years, it'll be 20 years old. And people still, you know, talk about it like it's like this just amazing action movie that, like I said, is still being lifted from to this day. So, yeah, Face Off all day, every day, but holy shit, if you haven't seen Broken Arrow, you're doing yourself a disservice. Go find it now and just have the fun with it. Because you will. I guarantee you will.
Yeah. That's all we've got?
Yes.
So hopefully you enjoyed the weekend's content, Gaming with Ash and AJ's movie reviews. I'm sure that was fun. Knowing what we had to watch this week, yes, I'm sure that was fun. Throwing it out, it's being filmed early because AJ's got to go out of town next week. That being said, Brand New Versus is coming next week, something we've been wanting to do for a long time, and it's finally coming to pass. Something that actually one of you out there did say that we should do as well. So, that's coming very soon. So, yeah, that's what we've got so far, and no worries about the content. Obviously, it will continue every day here on Pop. We got wrestling content, Blogger Randomness, Sip and Snack, you know how we do. Halloween Horror Nights content seems like every week now we get something new. And that's going to be the end of today's video. So, AJ, any parting words?
That's it.